Now let's consider the Laplacian. The Laplacian function, this is the Laplacian function, tells us about the rate of change. Again, these functions are given in the back cover of your book. What it is the, this is the divergence of the gradient of the potential. It's the same thing as being del squared, or this right here, second derivative in the x direction, second derivative in the y direction, second derivative in the z direction. Notice that the Laplacian is a scalar value, whereas the gradient is a vector value. This is telling us how fast the potential is changing. You are probably familiar with the rectangular coordinate notation, but let's take a look also at the cylindrical and the spherical coordinate notation. I want you to notice that you don't do the second derivative with respect to r. What you do is the first derivative with respect to r, then you multiply that function by r, and then you do the derivative again. The same thing is going to happen over here in the spherical coordinate system when you're considering the r term, the theta term, or the phi term. So right here, you'll take your derivative with respect to theta, multiply it by sine of theta, and then take the derivative of that entire function again. So just refer to the back cover of your book again when you need to calculate the Laplacian. Now here's how the Laplacian is most often used. We have two famous equations. One is called Poisson's equation. The other is called Laplace's equation. They are typically used for calculating the potential, and once you know the potential, you can calculate the electric field. What this says is that if you have a volume charge distribution given in coulombs per meter cubed, and you divide it by the electrical permittivity, put a negative sign in front, that tells you how fast the potential is changing. Let's see what that sort of means. If I had an electric charge distribution, something like this, each of those is producing an electric field or an electric flux, and that electric field or flux is producing a change in potential. This charge distribution right here is what's causing our electric field and hence our potential. Laplace's equation is for a charge-free region. What that means is that rho v is equal to zero. There are no charges. Typically this happens when you have a pure dielectric, and that means that the conductivity is equal to zero. If you have a pure dielectric, then you can have no free charges, and Laplace's equation applies. In that case, you can see that the second derivative of the potential is equal to zero, or the rate of change of potential is equal to zero. The way we most commonly use these equations is that we set up a boundary condition. For example, if we had a microstrip line like this, where we have a ground at the bottom and we have some potential here up at the top, say a source potential, we would be able to find the electric field or the potential in space in between these two plates using Poisson's equation and Laplace's equation. You will learn to do this in more detail in microwave engineering and probably also in numerical analysis. So what are the most important things to remember from today's lecture? I'd like you to remember that the electric field is minus the gradient of the potential. This allows us to find a vector from a change in a scalar value. The other thing is, please remember that the potential is minus the integral of E dot dl. And remember that it does not matter which path we go from point A to point B, we're still going to find the same potential shift. These are most often used when you have done a numerical analysis or a set of measurements of either the electric field or potential, and then you want to find the other factor. And then remember our two famous equations, the Poisson's equation, which relates charge to potential, and Laplace's equation, which tells us how potential varies in free space.